Good morning and good morning for those online. My name is Linda Young and I am a program officer with the Board on Chemical Sciences and Technology here at the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering and Medicine. I want to extend a warm welcome to all those, as I mentioned, in person and online. This is our third workshop out of our dissemination series centered on the recommendations and findings from the report, Why Indoor Chemistry Matters. Before I forget, for those in person, we have hard copies available outside, free to take. We invite you to please take a copy or two. The three sessions here are designed to drive conversations around crafting public health messages, understanding different occupancy environments, and navigating the complex ecosystems standards, guidelines, and regulations. Okay, so before we go on, I wanted to share a bit of housekeeping rules. For those participating online, I encourage you to use our Q&A feature. So please type in your questions or comments in the chat box. We'll try to make this as interactive as possible. And our moderators will try their best to get to your questions. For those participating online, we do have microphones on either aisles. Again, we also encourage you to please come up to the mic with your questions and comments. We want to make these workshops as interactive as possible. And next, I would like to express our gratitude to the Alfred Sloan Foundation. Their generous support has made this workshop and the previous workshops possible. I also want to take a special moment to thank our workshop moderators, Drs. Linda Birnbaum and Dr. Paula Osuski, who have graciously lended us their expertise and inquisitive personalities to moderate today's sessions. Dr. Linda Birnbaum is a scientist emeritus who specializes in toxicology and public health. She was the former director of the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. Prior to NIEHS, she spent 19 years at the EPA's Office of Research and Development. Dr. Birnbaum is a member of the National Academy of Medicine and has served as a member on several of NAM activities. I'll highlight just a few here. She was a committee member on the Standing Committee to advise the State Department on unexplained health effects on US government employees at overseas embassies. And she has been on the Roundtable of Environmental Health Sciences Research and Medicine, among several other activities. Dr. Birnbaum is currently a scholar in residence at the Nicholas School of the Environment at Duke University. And she's also an adjunct professor at the University of North Carolina, Yale University, as well as Duke. Dr. Paula Osuski, apologies, is a contributing scholar at the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security, where she leads the center's work on indoor air quality policy to mitigate airborne disease and global catastrophic biological risk. During her two decades at the Alfred Sloan Foundation, she led programs that produced lasting impact. Her accomplishments include the creation and direction of the microbiology of the built environment, chemistry of indoor environments, and biosecurity programs. She was chair of the EPA Homeland Security Research Subcommittee and was a member of the EPA Board of Scientific Counselors Executive Committee from 2014 to 2022. She is a member of the Academy of Fellows of the International Society for Indoor Air Quality and Climate and Fellow of the AAAS in Chemistry. Dr. Osuski received a PhD in biological chemistry at MIT and a BS in chemistry from Yale. Finally, I want to thank the National Academy staff, Darlene Groh, Kay Wims, and Eric Edkins, as well as Leslie, your invaluable support in handling the administrative and logistical operations for this workshop definitely made all the difference. Truly, truly thank you for your immense contributions in supporting this workshop. All right, so at this moment, I invite Dr. Osuski to the podium, who will introduce our keynote speaker.
Thank you, Linda. Good morning. I too want to express my thanks to the National Academies, the staff who have brought us together here. I also want to thank all the people who have participated on the committee that wrote the report, Why Indoor Chemistry Matters, and all the reviewers. And I actually was privileged to be one of the reviewers of the report. So it's a very exciting time to be here today. I thank all the speakers in advance. I thank people who are participants. And I think it's a very exciting time for indoor chemistry. And so having this this session, reaching communities for action is really important. So our first speaker today is a colleague of mine from Johns Hopkins, Dr. Leslie Quiros, who's an assistant professor at the Bloomberg School of Public Health. And I met her a number of years ago, and I could read her biography, but I suggest you read it. But what amazes to me is she manages to bring together sort of a high level science and epidemiology, but engages with really vulnerable communities to ask many questions that need answers, but sometimes people just don't know how to either access or to ask the questions. So she's a leader in this area. And so just thank you, Leslie. And we look forward to hearing your talk, Working with Vulnerable Communities to Impact Change, an Environmental Justice Framework for Exposure Science, Public Health, and Beyond.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Excellent. So good morning, everyone. I'd also like to thank the National Academy of Sciences, Dr. Anon, and Paula, and everybody else for being here today. It's truly an honor to be with you this morning. And today, like Paula said, I will be talking about working with vulnerable communities to impact change, an applied environmental justice framework for exposure science, public health, and beyond. So my charge this morning is to talk a little bit about how my research work and my research team got involved with a specific vulnerable community, in this case, hairdressers, to study as a research vulnerable study population, talk a little bit about the relationship building process and building trust, cultural considerations when conducting studies, some of the data that we collected and preliminary findings, the sharing of results and lessons learned on public health messaging, building community trust, and designing future studies. So because this work was conducted with an environmental justice framework and lens in mind, I wanted to briefly talk about and define what do we mean by environmental justice and what do we mean by vulnerable communities. So environmental justice is defined as a fair treatment and meaningful involvement of all people, regardless of their race, color, national origin, or income, when it comes to the development, implementation, and enforcement of environmental laws, regulations, and policies. But what do we mean by fair treatment and meaningful involvement? Well, by fair treatment, we're talking about making sure that no group of people and no one is bearing a disproportionate burden of environmental harms and risks, including those that may result from negative environmental consequences from industry, government, and commercial operations or programs and policies. And by meaningful involvement, we're talking about four specific things. The first one is that affected communities can participate in decisions that are being made about their environment and or health. The second is that the public's contribution can influence a regulatory agency's decision, that community concerns are being considered in the decision-making process, and lastly, that decision makers are making an intentional and genuine effort to seek out and facilitate involvement of those that are being impacted. Now, unfortunately, in the past, this hasn't always been done, right? There hasn't always been fair treatment or meaningful involvement when it comes to research, when it comes to local, federal, and state policies and regulations. However, fortunately, we are starting to see a shift. And what do we mean by vulnerable community in the context of environmental exposures? So we're referring to those individuals or communities that are at risk of exposure to environmental hazards and lack sufficient resources and knowledge to prepare for and cope with these risks. Now, there are select factors that contribute to vulnerability. These can include location, not only where vulnerable communities reside, where they're located, zip code, but the workplace as well. It has been widely documented that there are higher environmental exposures in low-income communities and communities of color, in large part due to practices that are rooted, unfortunately, in structural and systemic racism, including redlining, and individuals in these communities are also often the ones taking on the most hazardous jobs and being more highly exposed. Susceptibility of exposures is another factor that can contribute to someone's vulnerability, including life stage. For example, are we talking about pregnant women or women of reproductive age, as is the case today? Or just do individuals have pre-existing conditions that may render them more vulnerable and susceptible to environmental exposures, as well as genetics? And the last two select factors that contribute to vulnerability include access to proper healthcare and healthy foods, as well as consumer products, as well as the ability to anticipate, recognize, cope with, or recover from said environmental exposures. Now, environmental justice, or EJ, is just as important and essential where people reside as it is at the workplace. Work or working conditions are a social determinant of health, and unfortunately, it is often neglected when we're talking about public health research and interventions. The workplace can most definitely increase differential vulnerabilities that can lead to these health inequities. In fact, it's been documented that workplace conditions can account for about 30 to 55% of health outcomes and inequities that we're seeing in the US today. So this brings us to the research that I've been conducting with my team, in particular with a focus on hairdressers of color as a vulnerable population. And by the way, this is my community partner, friend, participant. She's been a real warrior and trooper during this last few years. So first of all, what led to this work and selecting this population? Why study hairdressers to begin with? Well, we know from US national biomonitoring data from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, or CDC, that women or females have a higher body burden of chemicals that are present in personal care and beauty products compared to the male counterparts, right? And these are, many of these chemicals are endocrine disruptors, which can alter or mimic hormone function in the body. And we know that hormones are play really important functions in our bodies, including growth, development, reproductive health, et cetera. And the same data is also showing us that it is among women, women of color, in particular Black and Latina women, that have a higher body burden of these chemicals compared to non-Hispanic white women. Now, this is likely due to sociocultural differences in product use. And what I mean by that is we know that women of color are using a greater variety of products in addition to using products that are specifically marketed to this demographic. And they're also using these products with greater frequency. Also been documented that racial and ethnic differences in beauty product use is prevalent across multiple categories when we're talking about skincare, hair care, and feminine hygiene product use. Now, use of select products is influenced by societal pressures and sociocultural norms to fit a Eurocentric beauty standard. So given that we know that females have higher exposures to all these chemicals and personal care products compared to males, and then among women, it's women of color experiencing higher exposures. This led us to ask the question, well, what about women who are not only being exposed from personal use, but also as part of their everyday job, right? So hairdressers. In the United States, there's over 700,000 hairdressers. This is a predominantly female, low-wage workforce. Over 95% of this workforce is females. About 30% of them are women of color. The average age is about 38 years of age, which means that these are women of reproductive age, which also tells us that exposures may not only pose a potential women's health risk, but also a children's health risk, because this is a population where females work during critical periods, including the preconception and prenatal period. In addition, women of color, especially those in low-income communities and low-wage jobs, may be further susceptible and vulnerable to the effects of chemical exposures, not only at their workplace, but by virtue of where they live, right, where they're residing. They're already being exposed to multiple environmental and social risk factors and are at an increased risk of facing poor health outcomes. They also face barriers in accessing safety resources when it comes to the workplace, and a lot of them are unaware of workplace hazards. So what do we know about chemical exposures among hairdressers? Well, chemical exposures in this population remains really understudied, and research to date has been very limited. In the United States, there have been very few studies, and really they have focused on just measuring and quantifying a select few indoor contaminants, in particular, a few volatile organic compounds or VOCs, or looking at exposures from specific care services, such as exposure to formaldehyde, from using straightening treatments, such as a Brazilian blowout. Epidemiologic or human studies, unfortunately, have been limited and inconclusive to date. Most of them have been conducted in Europe. They have relied on job title to assess exposure. So we have very little information when it comes to actual chemical exposures in this workforce. In addition, data on occupational exposures and health risks to workers serving racially and ethnically diverse populations is currently lacking, right? The products that are being used, for example, targeted to white women or white clientele are not going to be the same that are used on other populations. And we know that products that are targeted particularly to Black women contain many toxic chemicals. So what did we do to begin addressing some of these gaps and inform larger studies? Well, we conducted several pilot studies over the last 6 to 8 years in which we set out to first characterize indoor air quality and concentrations of indoor air pollutants, including particulate matter or PM, in addition to a panel of 14 volatile organic compounds or VOCs in 6 salons. And these were 3 salons mainly serving Black women and 3 salons were serving a Latino and Black clientele. We also conducted biomonitoring where we obtained post-shift urine samples to assess exposures to different chemicals, including 28 different VOC biomarkers, 9 phthalates. We've also done untargeted analysis. And as a comparison group, we also recruited 17 office workers of similar race and ethnicity to compare exposures. In addition, we assessed factors that have been linked to some of these exposures and obtained detailed health history using bilingual questionnaires. So now I'll be talking about some select preliminary findings from all of this work. So in terms of study population characteristics, our initial sample of 23 hairdressers and office workers, we found that they were intentionally racially and ethnically in general comparable groups. Hairdressers tended to be a little older at 40 years of age and office workers were 34 years of age. However, they were still women of reproductive age. Hairdressers earned a lower income. These participants were mostly non-smokers. And outside of the workplace, hairdressers reported more personal care product and beauty product use, as well as getting more hair treatments outside compared to office workers. And among hairdressers, 50% of them reported working while pregnant in the salon. And 2 of our study participants were actually in their third trimester when we conducted these studies. For some of our select indoor air results, we found that VOC or volatile organic compound median concentrations were 2 to 175 times higher in salons versus office spaces. We're not even talking about higher end exposures. We're talking about the median concentrations. They were already 2 to 175 times higher. For some chemicals, we weren't able to assess potential high end exposures because the instruments that we use pretty much reached saturation. Like, we had breakthrough in the sorbent tubes that we were using for these chemicals. And in terms of particulate matter, we found that particulate matter exposures were higher in salons serving mostly a Latina clientele than a Black clientele. This is likely due to the fact that there was a lot more hair blow drying going on in the Latina salons compared to the Black salons. Biomonitoring results. This shows different, this is box plots for each of the groups. We have, let's see. I apologize, I don't know where the pointer is, but basically here we have box plots showing the distribution of concentrations in each of these panels for different biomarkers or VOCs that we measured. On the left of each of these panels or in pink, is hairdressers, and then on the right-hand side of each of these panels or in the blue box plots, we see office workers. And we see that across the board, we found statistically significantly higher VOC biomarker concentrations among hairdressers compared to office workers. And for some of these, they were also more than 4 times higher than those observed among U.S. women. For example, for 1-bromopropane, acrolein, 1,3-butadiene, And these are VOCs that have been linked in animal studies to different adverse health outcomes, including cancer and adverse reproductive health respiratory and neurological effects in addition to liver and kidney damage. Now here we see comparisons of distributions for different VOCs among hairdressers. So we compared Black hairdressers compared to hairdressers working in Latino or Dominican salons, and we found that for VOCs, we saw much higher concentrations among hairdressers working in Black salons compared to those working in Latino salons. The opposite, and we did not find these differences for phthalates. Now for phthalates, when compared to, you know, hairdressers versus office workers, we're finding the same thing that we're finding for VOCs, right? Much higher concentrations of these chemicals in hairdressers compared to office workers. For example, geometric mean concentrations for MEP or methyl ethyl phthalate, which is a biomarker or degradation product of diethyl phthalate, which is present in many personal care products, was 10 times higher in hairdressers compared to office workers. Comparisons of MEP on the left or in blue compared to women in the general US population of the same age range as in our study on the right in red. And we see that median concentrations were already over 4 times higher than those observed among women in the US. We also found that median concentrations in hairdressers in our study were 41 times higher than those levels already associated with premature ovarian failure in other studies. And this is of concern because prenatal exposures to the parent compound of MEP, diethyl phthalate, has been linked with preterm birth, decreased anogenital distance in male infants, which can also impact fertility among males, pregnancy and pregnancy complications. And DEP, which is, again, the parent compound of MEP, is found in many cosmetics and personal care products. It's used as a fixative for fragrances. It's used in various hairsprays to avoid the stiffness that sometimes hairsprays produce. And it's also used in nail polishes and other consumer products. Now, we also asked hairdressers about the different products they were using, the different hair services that they were providing, because we wanted to see, are there higher exposures to some of these chemicals based on what they're reporting, including workplace characteristics or behaviors such as, are they wearing a mask? Are they wearing gloves, et cetera? And so here in this graph, above on the x-axis, we're seeing the parent compounds for which we measured breakdown products in urine. And on the left-hand side or y-axis, we're seeing the different workplace characteristics that we asked about, including, you know, different hair services, products that are being used, or behaviors such as whether they were wearing masks or not. And a plus sign indicates that there was a higher exposure among those women reporting affirmatively to either conducting that service or using a certain product. Whereas negative implies, you know, less concentrations among those who reported doing that particular behavior, such as, for example, wearing masks. If it's in deep purple, it means it's a statistically significant finding, but honestly, we were more concerned about looking at patterns at this stage to see what we were seeing. And one thing I want to highlight is that in recent years, you know, there's been a big push, especially among women of color, to go quote unquote natural, right? To not relax your hair, to not texturize your hair, because that's believed to be more toxic, less safe, et cetera. However, we're still seeing that with natural hair services, we're still seeing high exposures to different chemicals, right? Natural does not mean chemical free. There are still products that are being used for these services. And so that's something that we don't want to ignore. So the question was, why do they call them natural? Because it's thought to believe less toxic, less chemical intensive than hair relaxing or hair texturizing, which is meant to essentially change the structure of your hair to reach, you know, to for it to be straightened or whatever it is that they want to achieve with the hairstyle. No. So in terms of health history, We did ask a series of questions of different conditions, but today I'll just focus on what we found and observed related to respiratory health, as well as any women's health issues that we asked about. And so here we see the prevalence of asthma among US adults, which is 8.4, US women, which is a little bit higher at 8.9, and US Blacks, which is about 10.4%. And this is using data from the CDC. And we see that among hairdressers in our study, we had an even higher prevalence of asthma. We had a 17.4% prevalence of asthma. 75% of those hairdressers who said that they had asthma were diagnosed at some point during employment. 50% of them had an urgent care visit in the prior year. And some of the symptoms that were being reported during the work week included nasal irritation, trouble breathing at night, and wheeze. And while some of them experienced symptoms, they did still express that despite the symptoms and concerns that they just couldn't stop work, right? They couldn't risk wage loss. Now, in terms of gynecologic conditions and adverse pregnancy conditions and birth outcomes that we asked about, we can see here striking differences between hairdressers and office workers. So in these bar graphs, we see in blue hairdressers, and in green, we see office workers. And so we see here that across the board, there's a higher prevalence for many different conditions among hairdressers compared to office workers. So for example, menstrual cycle abnormalities, hairdressers had almost double the prevalence that we observed in office workers. And this is important not only from a fertility standpoint, but also menstrual cycle abnormalities have been linked to long-term chronic health conditions, including cardiovascular outcomes. Others that stand out also is the prevalence of miscarriage, with almost double that reported among hairdressers versus office workers. And there's a lot of these for which there was 0% prevalence among office workers, but we're seeing anywhere between 10 to 17% prevalence among hairdressers. So now I wanted to talk a little bit about this applied environmental justice framework that is not only relevant for exposure science research, but also public health research in general when we're talking about environmental exposures and how we were able to apply it and be successful, and we're continuing to apply it. This relates to 10 concepts that can serve as a roadmap for redefining how to conduct exposure science in a more just, inclusive, and equitable manner. So the first one is leadership. Leadership has to represent the community, right? Their lived experience is key in establishing trust with community partners. For us, it was critical and vital that we establish community partners and these relationships early on, right? I was not going to be successful if I just went knocking on random salons and went to the salon owner and said, hey, can I put instruments to measure the air in your salon, in the middle of your salon? And by the way, can I take urine samples from your workers at the end of their shift? And can I stick a nasal swab in their nose to look at, their nasal microbiome, right? That was not going to lead me anywhere. And so this was key. My two key and amazing community partners were Centro de Apoyo Familiar, or Center for Assisting Families, as well as the Health Advocates in Reach and Research Campaign, or HAIR Network, from the University of Maryland, led by Dr. Stephen Thomas. And also, diversity in leadership is essential. You want to conduct research that's being led by scientists and staff that's representing your community with which you're engaging, right? For us, this was key. My entire team was very diverse, and as well as bilingual. And also, this ensures that community concerns are being dismissed, right? The second is the priority of research questions are set by the most impacted. Now, communities that are proximal to their environment are experts as well, right? So we can't dismiss that. They're in that environment day in and day out. So they may be able to point things that we may have missed as researchers, right? By having a bird's eye view, we may have missed something. So it's key to engage them and allow them to also inform research questions. Community engaged and community driven models are effective to advance public health and more likely to be sustained when they're grounded in local systems and culture. Some of the challenges related to prioritizing research questions and having your community inform some of these questions is the balance between community concerns and pressing public health concerns to inform research priorities. And what I mean by that oftentimes the impacted community may not know that something may be of concern. Their concern might be something else, for example, mental health. It may not be chemical exposures because they're not in that headspace. They're not thinking about chemical exposures, right? It's not obvious or it may not be obvious to them. And so as researchers, I think we have to, you know, find a balance to where we prioritize concerns based on the exposures that are taking place. In addition, there's often lack of surveillance, right? So we don't know what's going on. For example, in the case of hair salons, for example, because they're small businesses, they are not subject to requirements from OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, where you have to report injuries and illnesses. If you have 13 or less employees, you do not have to report. So really, we don't know the prevalence of many different conditions in these workspaces, right, in salons. The third is shared funding or shared budget. You must compensate your community partners, right? They are giving you their time, and oftentimes they volunteer when there are no funds. So this is something that must be kept in mind. And also, in terms of compensation, don't just think monetary. You have to think of other ways in which you can give back to the community partners as well. And so in our case, what we did is that we not only compensated monetarily the salon owners and stylists, but we connected them with local resources. So that way, when funding was over and we no longer had the means, they would still be supported in other ways. And that we were also strategic in partnering with community partners that are already providing services, for example, to low-income communities. And we know that those are going to be sustained. The fourth is that it's measuring contaminants in a culturally and ethically responsible manner. You have to ensure that your data collection team is trusted by your target population. Also, your study instruments, for example, your questionnaires, should be informed and piloted with your target population before launching the study, which we did. We held focus groups with salon owners and salon stylists to make sure that we were covering the breadth, for example, of services and products that were being offered in salon spaces, as well as to make sure that we were asking questions in the right way. You also should prioritize exposures of concern that could be linked to suspected health effect concerns reported by the community when possible. And you should always have considerations for biospecimen collection and biobanking, right? You need to be very transparent with your population. You need to do this in your consent, in your returning of results. If you're biobanking, you need to be transparent and let your participants know. You need to get their consent for future use of their samples in future studies as well. And we have been really lucky. I would say over 98% of our participants always consent to future use of their samples. And we always, because there are a lot of resources going, being spent already in collecting and recruiting this population, it is always advisable to biobank, right? You may not have the funds now to assess given exposures, but funding will come eventually. And so those are precious samples that you want to keep if possible. But obviously with a consent from the participants that you can use their samples for future research. The fifth is that data collection involves impacted community. You have to establish and build trust prior to any data and sample collection because local and cultural knowledge is key. In addition, you want to tailor, I don't know what happened. We will be with you shortly. We're having technical difficulties with the slides. Okay, so moving on, sorry about that. You also need to make sure that these partnerships that you form are genuine and intentional. You need to involve your target population in research and in the monitoring process. This means that you're involving and engaging those community members, not only during the study, but also even beforehand, right? In the design, then execution, and then dissemination of results. This is key. And it's also often or always not enough to just document injustices and exposure disparities. Research has to inform action and policies to protect the impacted populations, even when quote unquote more research is needed, right? We will always say more research is needed because we never have all the resources needed to conduct the perfect studies. However, there's always information that we do know at the time. And so with the data that we have on hand, how can we best inform and offer recommendations to protect these populations? The sixth is that of data ownership. You need to ensure that data collection is done through an equitable lens. Your impacted population has to have a voice on what information can and cannot be used for. You should also have processes in place to ensure shared governance. Again, it's important to involve your community partners and community members in the dissemination of results. We have included our community partners in manuscripts, presentations, as well as in the sharing of results. When we were designing the sharing of results, as well as when we executed distributing the sharing of results with our participants. The seventh, which leads me to this, is communication and results dissemination. Again, it's critical for them to be engaged. The translation of data has to be done in an accessible knowledge form to inform action and interventions that are valuable. It has to be done in an ethical manner to increase knowledge within the communities and promote evidence-based policies for optimal health outcomes. And this is sometimes challenging when we are not certain what these levels might mean. However, coordination in the community should be conducted prior to any information being released to external to those not in the study, such as in publications or in platforms such as this one. Now, the eighth is that of participative justice, which refers to the direct participation of those most affected by a particular decision or policy. And we have had our pilot studies that were informed by hairdressers. Each pilot study sort of kept informing future pilot studies and also informed our recently funded R01. The ninth, which is the second to last, a concept that I'll go over is engagement in actions and policies. We need to ensure that we're engaging key stakeholders at all levels toward actual change, right? It's not enough for public health professionals to recommend individual reduction exposure behaviors. We have to move away from that and demand structural changes. And this, of course, takes considerable time and resources. The 10th is that of sustainability and capacity building. Long-term sustainability of interventions and any exposure mitigation strategies that we implement should be aimed at reducing risk of harm and any adverse health risks associated with these. This sustainability and capacity building is also key when you're establishing your partnerships and building trust. And successful research teams recruit participants from these communities, hire community members as part of their staff, and build in sustainability and capacity building to those impacted communities. So for example, again, as the example I gave you before, not only were we providing monetary incentives, but we were equipping our target population with resources within their communities so that once we no longer had funding, they were still getting assistance. In terms of public health messaging, including the dissemination of results, I know that the next panel will be touching on this, but just for a little background, it should be clear, concise, actionable, culturally appropriate and accessible, and informed by the community. And this includes, is it in the proper language? Is it in the proper platform that we want to provide it into our particular target population? Cultural considerations are always key when conducting these studies. Again, this was key to inform our study instruments in order to get more accurate data. It was key for us to hold focus groups, to pilot the questionnaire several times before we even launched the study. Incentives should be of value to the community. It's possible that your given community could care less about monetary incentives, right? But they may need other things. And so this should be kept in mind. It should inform sustainable interventions. It's essential to build trust, and study team members should have representation from your target population. Now, some of the challenges and lessons learned moving forward, something that's been a recurring theme is that obviously community partnerships are key in all of these studies in every phase of the study, right? In the design, execution, and report back. Also, building trust is key, and it does take a considerable amount of time. Sustainable interventions are necessary. Also, we need to keep thinking about how do we equip these vulnerable communities and populations with the tools necessary for them to have a voice and to start taking action. And lastly, but not least, is understanding how structural racism plays a role on exposure to these relationships in moving forward. And conducting, you know, work in the space of exposure disparities and health disparities, I wanted to mention this. And, you know, this, so here's a doctor and an elephant on a couch, and the elephant is saying, sometimes even if I stand in the middle of the room, no one acknowledges me. And we're talking about systemic and structural racism, right? We're talking about that until we start addressing the systemic and structural issues, that we will continue to see exposure disparities and health inequities in the most in vulnerable populations that are suffering the burden of disease and the burden of exposures. So we can't work in silos and continue ignoring this. So it's going to take a village and genuine intent to protect the most vulnerable and ensure everyone's right to health equity to do this. So I want to acknowledge my entire research team, the funders, community partners, as well as the salon owners and study participants, and all the student interns and volunteers that made this work happen. And lastly, thank the audience for being here this morning. Thank you.
I mentioned my mother was a hairdresser. I'm a different demographic, but most women I know who go to the hair salon have relationships with the people who take care of them. Okay. It's not a casual situation. And so I admire the work that Leslie has been doing, because this is a very vulnerable population. And I could, what is the air quality? What's in the products? So on. So anyway, but I will, before I start asking my questions, I'll open it up to the audience, both in the room and outside the room. Linda?
Linda Birnbaum. I just wanted to ask the question. I thought this was a wonderful talk, and thank you again for going through the 10 key points of environmental justice. I just wanted to, there have been some studies done on Vietnamese, for example, working in nail salons. And again, there are similarities and differences. And I wonder if you had any insight into that as well.
Thank you. So thank you for the question. For those of you online, the question was, do I have any comments related to the fact that some studies have been done with a focus in nail salons and Vietnamese workers? And so at the time when we set out to do the study, because there were already studies going on in Vietnamese women, but none in hairdressers, that's what sort of led me to push and go this route. I can tell you that there have been a few studies. For example, I know there's one that measured phthalate biomarkers, and we're finding similar or higher concentrations in the hairdressers that participated in our studies. There are also, keep in mind that so some salons also offer nail services as well. So we took that into account as well. And so I think that there are both highly vulnerable populations that should not be dismissed. But that's sort of what led us to focus on hairdressers and not nail salon workers, because work was already being done in that space at the time.
That's one comment about phthalates.
Yes. 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 Again, a lot of the reasons why we're concerned about exposures in this population is because it's not only a women's health issue, but like Dr. Birnbaum was saying, it's a children's health issue, right? Again, these women are working during the preconception period. A lot of them work during, you know, while they're pregnant. And so there are concerns about exposures during their prenatal period impacting their children's health, including respiratory health, including neurodevelopmental effects. Yes, absolutely.
Good morning. Thank good you morning. Very much. I think you gave a masterclass that other academicians can use in terms of how to engage and do this type of work at the community level. My question has to do with the location of the salons. Did you look at, you know, were they like in urban areas? And then where the women lived and how perhaps the outdoor air quality in those spaces and their exposure in the other parts of their life may have been impacted.
Absolutely.
Some of the results that you have.
Absolutely. So the question was, did we consider or look at where the women lived outside the workplace and also outdoor exposures and where these salons were located? So that is a great question. Unfortunately, we were limited by resources and staffing. It was, when I first started this work, it was me and two students going into salons and doing, putting all of this equipment in, taking all these samples. Going back, I would have absolutely done measurement of outdoor exposures outside of the salon and then asked a little more about their home environment. That is something we did not do, again, because we were limited. But moving forward, in the new grant that was funded, we do plan to do that.
Thank you. Just one follow-up. It's something that...
Closer to the microphone.
Oh, please. Okay. Can you hear me better? Yes, I'm Laurel Royer. Nice to... Great to be here. One of my interests, too, is related to labels on products. And so as we take this information and this very important work that you're doing, is there opportunity or can you share some thoughts on how do we better teach salon owners and just folks in general to read labels and perhaps take it a little bit further, engaging with the folks who put the labels on to make folks, and I know that's sort of like perhaps much further. It's a bigger picture, perhaps more complex, but I just wanted to share, ask your thoughts on that.
So thank you for the question. The question was on labeling and how we can better inform consumers, including salon owners. And it's interesting you asked that because in the beginning, we set out to document the products that were being used and to look at the ingredients, but we actually had to quickly abort and for different reasons. One is I remember my student calling me and saying, you know what, I'm getting a massive headache. I'm getting a migraine from being here. And I said, okay, you're going to leave and come in and out at, you know, to look at the equipment, make sure it's working properly, but I don't want you in that space for now. And this is just a student going in for, we're not even talking about the workers there that are there for hours. Also, when we're talking about salons that are serving, you know, women of color, women, it's possible for women to bring in their products and ask the hairdresser to use their product. We also saw, I vividly remember like a whole shelf full of, I'm not kidding, over 50 products that a hairdresser had. How do we know how often she's using it? Which ones she's using? Like it just got overwhelming quickly, right? And this issue about labeling, sometimes the chemical name can be on the label, but if I don't know anything about it, it means nothing to me, right? That's one thing. Sometimes people talk about, oh, you need a safety data sheet. What good is that? To the common person, and all of us actually, if you read a safety data sheet which talks about the chemicals, they're useless. Manufacturers are not also required to list all of the ingredients. For example, they can list parfum or you know perfume or fragrance as an ingredient, and that fragrance can contain 1, 2, 3 hundreds of chemicals. Some of which could be phthalates, right? Sometimes we don't know what the product contains. So I think we need to go even further and start demanding safer product manufacturing, right? The labeling is used to me. This is my personal opinion. Sure, I can go in as a consumer and try to avoid things that have phthalates, but what about everything else that's in that product that we don't know about, right? Because it hasn't been studied. So it is very challenging.
All right, as a moderator, I have a burning question. Yeah. You know, since you work closely with these salons and the communities, did they change any of their practices while, you know, based on the study?
Some did, some stopped relaxing and texturizing hair. And again, relaxing and texturizing hair is meant to change the structure of your hair and use, you know, a lot of toxic chemicals. Some completely stopped. And some even started moving away from products and making their own natural products. But again, that has to be also informed because you want to make sure that if they're making products that they're not making something toxic as well.
And we don't need to go into the details of the chemistry, but there are sort of, it is redox chemistry in terms of what you're doing to sulfur bonds and opening them up and so on. But anyway, all right. So we have more questions from people here because I know we have a lot of questions online. All right, Linda. Let's see. Did the study comparing the exposure levels of the indoor chemicals with those salons are predominantly? Did you basically look at white salons?
So the question is, did I look at white salons? No, we didn't. And it was honestly resources. We had a limited number of resources, so we decided to focus on salons serving predominantly, you know, women of color. However, we are going to include quote unquote white salons in our currently funded grant. Yes.
And as an indoor chemist who goes to white salons, I can assure you they have a lot of chemicals there. And I'm probably one of the few clients that brings in their CO2 meter. But anyway, all right. So we have another question here. Is there a legal or regulatory framework in place for ventilation requirements for salons?
So that's a great question. So a lot of standards are pretty much left up to the state, and they can vary from state to state. In terms of ventilation, the guidelines are very vague. I have seen some of these guidelines, and they'll say things such as, if you're conducting work with quote-unquote hot tools, you need to work in a well-ventilated space, but there's no description of what well-ventilated space is. I have also seen recommendations made for salons to open windows. Well, every salon that I went to had no windows, so there is no window to open. And even if they open windows, another thing to keep in mind is that some of these are located in high traffic areas, right? So there's challenges in this environment that we need to look at.
Have you considered, I realize it's resource constrained, and I'm so excited that you got the big grant. Have you considered working with people at hairdressing schools, like who teach how to do these procedures, or just sort of work a little bit upstream?
We have, and that's something that we considered, and we still haven't discarded that as an option. Yep.
So we have another question that says, in terms of interventions, what types of masks are most effective at lowering biomarkers of exposure?
So that's a great question, and we actually want to look at that further. So I didn't mention this before, but most of this work, at least the one where we asked if they wore masks, occurred before COVID. And we want to look at this further because we didn't really ask what type of mask they were wearing. So this is something that we're going to be looking at in this grant. So thank you for the question.
Are there any, companies working in this space who are trying to, because I've seen the move towards personalized hair care products. Are there any companies trying to develop better products for these salons?
To my knowledge, I'm not aware of them. I know there are some more organic versions, but mostly this is in Europe. I'm not aware of any in the US. And if anybody knows, please.
Right, now we have a technical question. What equipment did you use for your measurements?
Oh gosh. It's on the manuscript. I can't remember exactly what we used sorbent tubes to take workplace samples in the workspace. We also had real-time PM monitors, a dust track, what else? A PID, So those are some of the instruments that we used.
So if you could influence the salon owners to take one step to improve the situation, what's the one step you would have them start with?
Oh gosh, that's the elephant in the room too. I guess highlight that there's sometimes there's small steps we can take to start reducing exposures. Trying to, for example, limit the amount of products that we're using. But this may not be possible for everybody, right? Limit the types of services that you're providing. For example, I know that my community partner completely ceased relaxing or texturizing hair because of this study, as well as other studies that have been coming up. So I would, this is a hard question.
That's why I asked it, because often when I'm trying to help people improve their indoor air quality, they say, well, what do I do first? So I was hoping
it's a great question and challenging, because sometimes they don't have control over the ventilation system, right? Because they're renting space. So, and they could use air purifiers, air filters in their space, but are they going to keep up with the maintenance and change the air filters as often as they should be? And that's something we also want to look, we want to look for potential no cost to low cost solutions moving forward in this work as well.
Just more questions here, Linda and then Seema.
Mine is more common, and it goes back to what we were talking about a little while ago about what's in our products and we don't know them. There is a pretty good app called Clearia. Yes. C-L-E-A-R-Y-A, that you can just point it at your product and it will give you a lot of information about what's in it. And there are hundreds of products that they have. Now, whether certainly all of the ones that are used in beauty salons are probably not there, mm-hmm. but it might be a good start.
Thanks for an amazing talk. Can you guys hear me? I have a question just following up on what you said about Europe. And about why are they better? Why is it better there? And, you know, in general, and this comes up in multiple forums, this is one particular type of exposure, but whenever we're talking about chemicals in general, European cohorts, this is a very unscientific statement here, but I'm just going to say in a hand-wavy way, they tend to look better. And so what is Europe doing on a, you know, policy or systemic level that's working that we need to be doing?
And as the moderator, I've recruited the other moderator to answer this question.
So Europe has a different program. It has a program called REACH, which basically says you've got to do some safety testing of chemicals before you allow them on the market. In our country, chemicals are assumed, not pharmaceuticals, but other kinds of chemicals, including cosmetics, are assumed safe until proven unsafe. And that doesn't usually happen until there's a problem reported.
Right. And oftentimes, even if there's reports, for example, to the FDA, they don't have to do anything about it.
All right, I think our time is up. Would you join me in thanking Dr. Keira for a really fabulous presentation?
Good morning. It's my real pleasure to introduce the first session here on implementing research data into practice and vice versa, summarizing and analyzing data to create public health messages. And our speaker who is going to lead off this whole session is Dr. Vito Ilacqua from US EPA. He's the acting director of the Center for Scientific Analysis in the Indoor Environments Division in the Office of Air and Radiation at EPA. And he's got lots of experience in looking at how indoor air, for example, intersects with exposure science and public health as well. He received his doctorate from New Jersey, from Rutgers University, but comes to us before that from Milano, Italy. And it's my pleasure to have him present his talk on indoor air guidance and development at EPA. And I can't wait to hear it, Vito, because it's been a long time coming. So thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for the introduction and thank you for the invitation to speak here. It would really be nice if I could tell you about how we translated this report into guidance at EPA, but that is still in process. And frankly, events like this workshop are really some of the input that goes into it. And so instead, I will give you a little bit of information about how we do indoor air guidance development at EPA. And first, the obligatory disclaimers, which in so many words, it's that nothing that you see is endorsed by the agency in terms of products. And also everything I say can be used only against me and not against the agents. We'll talk really about three things, a little bit of how we use science in the guidance development, some examples of how we did that, and then some of those challenges and opportunities that I see and perhaps can be discussed later in the session. So in terms of clarifying that we are all talking about the same things, by the way, you see our webpage, which is a starting point for all indoor air quality things at EPA. Guidance is straightforward enough, but with indoor air, we really mean certain environments specifically, and particularly excludes all places where there can be professional specialized exposures, and those are regulated elsewhere. That's the main reason for this distinction. In terms of goals, what's the purpose of our guidance? Well, it's really to reduce the health effects or at least exposures. That's the problem or difficulty here. But it's really helpful sometimes to think in positive terms instead of reducing health effects, promoting desirable health and well-being. Sometimes you get more attention that way. The minimum components of this really are the fact that we are not talking about regulatory applications, and that's intended to influence policy or individual decision makers in the public, people deciding whether to open their window or not, for example. It must be supported by scientific evidence, and we'll talk a little bit about what that means, and it really has to be practically feasible, and that's something that you may have seen before. The process of the developing regulation is perhaps more well known, how EPA does that. And I'm getting some of this graphic from this great book, Science at EPA. It's really any number of combination of different processes. So the science can be generated internally or externally. It can get to EPA directly or mediated by some organizations such as the National Academies, but also advocacy or community groups, anything really. And then it's elaborated internally and presented to decision makers. This is not very different from what we do for guidance, but with some significant differences in that the decision makers are not within EPA. It can be Senate confirmed executives, or it can really be, that's the case of the regulatory process, but in our case, it's people in the public. It can be really any organization or individuals. We generally don't have to do risk assessment, although if it's available, we use it, and we don't need to make this as public. But there are many parallels. I really want to highlight one from this book, is that the decision makers, whether the executive appointed by the Senate or the individual in their home, doesn't necessarily get all the details of the science behind the statement. And we'll come back to this later. So in terms of the idealized process, really, I'll give you, it starts always from the scientific literature through a search process that I won't get into. You get some relevant literature. And then from that, we extract two things, really, the health and exposure outcomes, and then the options for action. And these, particularly the options for actions, can also come directly from the public or from other groups, particularly stakeholders. And these two things are really combined to create a draft guidance. From here on, and this process can be done internally by EPA, or it can be done by any number of organizations. And we have definitely worked with the national academies a number of times. And from here on, then this draft guidance goes through a very intensive process of review that can be as time consuming as generating the draft guidance. It's internal for policy, communication, science, but it also can be external from peer review to advisory boards, stakeholders, and so on. And eventually what emerges is final guidance. And this is released through the public through a number of different means that can include specific training of specific groups rather than just generalized release. And then this results in systems or policy changes. And not every step happens every time and not necessarily in this order, but this is the process. I don't want to give you the impression that this is only a linear process. We have the vice versa in the title here. And this is really something we try to capture. So there's a circular process here where the results inform the next steps. But guiding the feedback, I think we've seen in the previous presentation and also elsewhere, it's helpful during the guidance development, but it's also helpful afterwards, really, to gauge the effectiveness of what we're doing. Unfortunately, we can't really just go and ask people directly. Congress, in their wisdom, has decided to protect citizens from this type of requests. And so generally in every organization, as if you elevate the level of the decision, that means you're trying to discourage the process from happening. And we do have to rely on indirect evidence for most of these events. Sometimes we can get direct survey data. I'll show you an example. In the larger context of public health, really, this is showing how we hope that the process works. We inform the public, or we inform particular groups that have the ability to change how things work. And this hopefully results in exposure reduction and reduction of health effects. We can think of this process of knowledge transfer really is similar to education in some ways. People who have experience teaching, sometimes you're communicating with an audience who has variable range of interests, really, and engaging with those that don't have an interest is problematic. But I think that the better model for this is really science translation, and the National Center for the Advancement of Translation Science has created this wonderful set of principles and even equally wonderful badges that really capture the challenges of some of these principles. And I'm going to use them in later in the presentation when we think that we applied them. It's also useful to think about the epistemological framework of how we do this guidance development. This is not really something EPA thinks, it's more of a personal reflection, but all these, you know, the traditional way of saying something is true is to say it corresponds to reality. You can recognize some names from high school here, but this is the most obvious, and it really is important here. In fact, we insist on empirical science to develop guidance, even when we could be saying things from models. And so the requirement for specific guidance, particularly in field studies, is always there. Another way to look at it is that the information, something has to be really agree with other things that we know, right? And this is also something that we see reflected in the guidance development, in the fact that we seek consensus. But this does create problems sometimes when crossing discipline boundaries. And finally, another way is to look at, well, something is true if it works or if it passes some socially accepted process. These two things are substantially equivalent. And we do also take that approach into mind. So this is something that we see everywhere at EPA. There's a totality of the evidence considered in developing either regulations or guidance. And since we talk about the epistemological framework, it's good to acknowledge our paradigm. Our paradigm, proven now by decades of research and practice, is really source control, ventilation, and filtration, which sometimes it becomes a challenge. More recently, by the development of the concept of equivalent ventilation. And so that's why it is something really worth acknowledging for us, that this is in the background of everything that we do in our guidance. In terms of summarizing the science, I'm not going to go into explaining how we do it, but I want to highlight one great resource that exists in the world of indoor air, which is the Scientific Findings Resource Bank developed at the Berkeley Lab, and which is one of the primary top really research centers in the world on indoor air quality. And they really pick different topics and summarize them at this level. For example, you see here something about VOCs. So if you really want the gist, this is one great way to go. And then you can go deeper in depth as much as you want. I want to say something about the role of our advisory boards, and particularly because the Clean Air Act Advisory Committee has worked on the National Academy's Indoor Chemistry Report. And so they came up with a set of recommendations of those things that are feasible short-term and particularly suitable to EPA. We have a whole list of things that are to be addressed first, including really looking at the research on health effects. And particularly interesting is should we disseminate decisions, some things that one may not think about, such as participation in standard writing committees. But also, and this will come up in a later session today, the focus on human behavior. All the activities that people do in their environments can have an impact on chemistry, and we really need to understand this aspect much more. And then, of course, we have just been talking about health disparities and environmental justice. This is an area in which really we see that we should be directing a lot of our research resources in particular as well. And then they talk about air cleaners as an area of focus, and particularly the need for standardized consensus methods for testing. This is something that really does come up in standards, for example. And they also gave us a list of priority contaminants. In particular, I want to highlight reactive oxygen species, and we'll come back to that as well. So that's a little... about the process, let me tell you a little more about some of the examples. The most typical one of those that we did is the development of our air cleaner guidance. This was an update of the previous one that we did in 2018. It was performed internally, but with expert contractors. I'll claim some of the badges here in the process. And it was substantially a literature review. Then the whole document was peer reviewed, and it's both general public guidance and a much more detailed technical guidance, obviously intended for different audiences. And these are some examples of the questions that we were able to address, in some cases with unequivocally, and in others with some uncertainty level. But this has been a really interesting area for the public. We see here the public interest in the topic. You also see the difference here in the use of terminology. Air purifier seems to be much more popular in the way people use it rather than air cleaner. And I also want to point to the numbers. We don't have the earlier ones because we changed our system, but I want to point to the numbers of people looking at this page. It's in the tens of thousands, not the hundreds of millions. So we have to think about who are we reaching in with this guidance, and we'll come back perhaps to that. Second example was totally different, and not typical at all, the development of the COVID-19 guidance. And it wasn't typical because of the speed, because the science was evolving like not by the minute, but certainly by the day. And the empirical research, first there was nothing and then there was a flood. So it was a really interesting process. This was done internally, and we settled on making both question and answers and traditional web pages so that we could have both the timely aspect and the more rigorous approach. And this reflected even questions that were coming into the agency from the public, things that we may not have thought about when we write about ventilation. Did we think about evaporative coolers or whole house fans? No, but people asked those questions and we were able to introduce them directly. Some of you may remember at the time it was really controversial between fields, as I was saying before. What some health organization intended as airborne transmission and what the indoor air community intended were different. There was a contentious at the beginning this process. And so we decided to take really a bold approach and go with the indoor air consensus at the time. But it was really key to be able to consult with people that were straddling all these fields. And eventually we ended up taking the unusual step of having technical reference page, which normally we don't do, talking about all the information and details of what we are saying. But eventually partnerships with other organizations caught up, and this one of the moments I was most proud of our management, being able to make these partnerships happen with other agencies, for example. The interest that followed really the pandemic in the downloads and the views of our pages, and these were some of the most visited pages in the agency. But even so, even if you total it up, we get into the millions. So if the goal is that everyone in every household has seen these pages, maybe this is not what we are achieving, but maybe this is not what we're trying to achieve, and we'll come back to that. We also did webinars that we're trying to reach particularly the school audiences, because there was a lot of demand for that. The third example I'll give you is also atypical. It was not developed in our specific office, but it was flooded homes guidance. This comes with indoor air quality issues, and the question is, when can residents go back? And there's a difference between the technical guidance. This is one document we have that talks in language like this, and what people really want to know. If you're a survivor of a flood, what do you want to know in the moment? And so this project really looked at trying to find a way to address these concerns really directly for future floods, of course, not those happening at a particular moment, and use this strategic action learning tools framework that really has, is very widely applicable, but really looked in, takes a detailed look at really what are people thinking, doing, what are their values, their needs, and so on, in ways that are reminiscent of the presentation we just saw. And then the goal was to try to develop a website that would use human-centered design in ways that the guidance would be understandable by everyone that ended up there. And we and the process really used extensive reviews and involvement of the potential target audiences in coming up with this type of guidance and testing of how usable it is and so on. So what was learned from this? Well, you need a lot of cross-boundary participation of the cross disciplines, as we said. It takes a lot of time It takes a lot of time because you can't assume that people are necessarily available. Interested recruiting is a step that is important. Trust must be earned, but also the interest must be earned on before you can get people involved. And so there's some lessons for the future on how getting even more community involvement in the process. And the last example here is on guidance that didn't come out. This was on vacuum cleaning, for example. And it was very similar in the people involved, the scope and so on for what we did for air cleaners. But when we started looking at the literature, the answers just were not quite clear enough to come up with it. There's, can I vacuum to help with allergies? Maybe. Can it help with, you name the issues? Maybe. There were some successful interventions, but really not quite clear. And particularly, this was the sticking point. How often should I vacuum? The evidence here was all over the place, and maybe we did see in the literature some results, but steps that are impractical. So really, this is on hold, hoping that further development in the literature can help us advance this to a point where this can be turned into guidance. Last, let me talk about some challenges and opportunities. And so what can we do better? A ton of different things, I'm sure, and some will come out here, but we always have to remember that we are bound by this iron triangle of project management, really. And if we cannot accept low quality, then we're always gonna be stuck between the expensive and the slow. Typically the slow, you are seeing in this case. But in my mind, one of the things that we definitely can do better is communicating the uncertainty, the evolving nature of our knowledge. This is something that there are cons. There is a reason why we don't give busy executives or people with limited interest a lot of information. But at the same time, this comes back to us in the form of, oh, those, they always change their mind. We see it in, for example, the nutritional guidance field. The people perceive changing of the guidance as a negative thing. And that, I think, is a failure of the communication of uncertainty. So I won't go any further in detail on this one because it could be its own workshop, but I think there's a scope there for improvement. The next is really thinking about how precisely are we reaching the audiences that we are trying to reach. Clearly, we are not trying to reach everyone, or at least we don't have the means to do it, but we should think about how we do this through third parties better. And then the gathering the feedback. Is the what we are putting out relevant and accessible? And most important, eventually, does it translate into behavior change, exposure reduction, health benefits? So let's look a little bit about the these two. Interpretability. So when we are writing, who are we writing for? And there was a National Academies report on health literacy that starts pretty discouraging. If you start from this point of view, you should be writing at middle school level, and even that perhaps with some challenges. And we probably should communicate graphically more often, but even that is not as straightforward as it thinks. Even graphical representations can be read in different ways. But then it's not quite as bad as this initial position might look like, because the target of a public health benefit is not necessarily the user or reader, if you think about it. And an example is our Tools for Schools guidance. The vast majority of people that it's intended to protect, just numerically, are students. But we don't write for students, we write for facilities managers, school boards, you name it. So one of the ways we try to approach and we can probably do better is in this hub and spoke website design, where there's a intro page and then people can go into that as they see fit or as it suits them. or we have seen the general plus technical guidance development. And this is a second point that perhaps it's hard for people like us, people attending this webinar. We shouldn't think that people who don't have the analytical skills to interpret a text are unable to access the information. This is perhaps one of the way we think, because we are used to doing things that way, but there are many other ways in which people can address the problem. And there are social support mechanisms in particular that I think we tend to discount substantially in that respect. And then, of course, professional intermediaries that can be from the healthcare work to the media and so on. And so let's talk a little bit about those. Are we really reaching the people that we are trying to? And I really like how my colleague, Lorraine Burton, put it, you know, making a message actionable requires talking to the people who actually take the action. And I couldn't think of a more pithy way to put it than in these terms. And so one group, for example, is HVAC technicians. And it seems like that would be a good group to target for communications on this. And I have to say, personally, my experience has not been great. A lot of conversations with people coming to my home for this type of service have included things such as, oh, Raiden is not a real thing. It's all made up by EPA, or you don't need a energy recovery ventilator in this climate, or the filter is just to protect the device and not for the house. Going deeper, it seems to me it's not really lack of knowledge. It's really the fact that some of these interventions don't really fit in the business model, in the business model of the HVAC service industry yet, at least. Installing things that they are not used to having around it doesn't pay off, essentially. And we could go deeper in this in the discussion, but another group is healthcare professionals, and there are sometimes position papers like this one that you can see. But when you go to do your annual physicals, do you get in the screening questions a lot of environmental health, let alone indoor air questions? I personally don't. And last, we talked about community-based organizations, and EPA makes a significant investment in this area. But we also should try and keep in mind, this was a report of the Surgeon General from last year, the loneliness epidemic may be changing the way that I talk about the social aspect of access to information. Maybe this is being impacted by this, and we need to think about that in a changing, more individual-based world. Engaging product manufacturers could be another group. I will say that the key here is thinking about public health at the product design stage. And this is a message for manufacturers, but also we should think about it as an agency. It can be scary to approach a government agency and say, we're thinking of doing this, because for many reasons, but of course they might say things that we don't want to hear. But I really want to acknowledge the Association of Home Appliances Manufacturers in this area for reaching out with public health in this area. But it's really something that I want to give an example of. I am running out of time, but it is really one example we've seen in the design of air cleaners. There are multi-stage air cleaners. Something different can be done at the design stage. It could be really beneficial, but we see this put at the last stage of air cleaner devices, where reactive oxygen species are released into the indoor environment instead of being trapped before. And I was saying an example of feedback collection. We were able to do a survey with CDC a couple of years ago, scrolling slowly towards publication. People really, a substantial fraction of people want to know more, want to know how to achieve better indoor air quality, where to put their cleaners, where to how to choose their HVAC filters. And after economic considerations, lack of knowledge is really what we are seeing as the main spot. There's all sorts of other challenges that we could discuss here. I don't feel particularly troubled by the amount of misinformation, let's put it that way. This is because it's probably always been a problem, and it's not something that I think doesn't resolve itself. What worries me the most here is the political polarization that we see in guidance, because that really creates an impenetrable wall to communication. And I'll finish just in a minute talking about artificial intelligence. This is a query to ChatGPT 3.5. It's not the latest, and it was trained on before the release of the National Academy's report. It's actually pretty reasonable. It includes some statements, however, that are puzzling. I mean, I spend my time thinking about this type of concepts, and I really had to think about it. Indoor air chemistry influences the effectiveness of ventilation. Is it true? Am I missing something here? And mostly no, it's not really true, but it seems true. And large language models do this aspect of shaping words in a way that can be potentially very useful. And to me, the analogy for those who have read Dan Kahneman's bestseller, Thinking Fast and Slow, is with System One. It's fast, it comes up with things. You'd really have to think if it's about the accuracy. But hopefully we can move eventually to model trained on one set for the language and another set for the content. There are still some problems with that. But the modulating language for specific language for specifically is something that they do very well. Eventually we'll transition to things that have physical models built in. And so I'm looking for digital agents and artificial general intelligence. We're waiting if you think it's achievable. Let me spend the last two slides on a minute looking at this language modulation. This is actually a hard question. It was asked to me, explain this how you would to an eight-year-old. It was asked to me as a qualifier a question in my PhD exam. It's hard, it would take time, and it does it reasonably well. I mean, you can cringe about some things, but now imagine there are special detectives called scientists. We can change language like that, but it would have taken me much longer to come up with this than this way. But I don't have an eight-year-old, I have a teenage daughter, and I'm forever telling her to open the window when painting her nails. And so, let's try this. And I have it on good authority that the tone is right. Although she said, it's not really convincing. And that's true, actually, if you take the time to read the argument. And of course, when I showed her this, I walked right into this. And the question is, humor aside, is that it's really picking the right topics. It's really talking about exposure or the lack of exposure information. Of course, it doesn't know anything. How does it know I have decent ventilation in our home? But it is an interesting way of formulating the language, and we're close to being able to make this useful, let's say. So to conclude, general science translation principle is what we're trying to follow. So empirical research, multiple levels of review, actionable steps. But it's really hard to include all those translation science principle when we do guidance. And you've seen not every example had every badge. And there's lots of things that we can concentrate on improving, but definitely I would say gathering feedback and then getting and learning directly from the people that are implementing things. And hopefully we can gain on the resource limitation aspect with some use of AI. So thank you. And let me stop and thank my colleague in particular.
So Vito, that was masterful. And again, we've had great introductions and kind of great lectures to get us all going today. I just have one question, which is, you started off by talking about that the objective of the guidance was that it should be actionable to deal with problems. I want to hear about prevention. How do we think going forward about problems that we're not even sure have happened yet, but knowing something about it and working with our communities might raise concerns?
No, and that there's the easy way to answer this and the harder way. And the easy way is to say, yes, we are already thinking about it this way because we're trying to generally limit all kinds of exposures to sources. And that's part of our guidance. The harder part is really what you actually were addressing in responding to a question before. There are a lot of things that we would sometimes like to say about products, and we don't have the type of evidence yet to prove it's actually harmful. So the presumption of it's safe unless proved and harmful definitely bears on a lot of what we say here. A practical example, we are able to say, don't use air cleaners that generate ozone into occupied spaces. There are other things that we would like to be able to say, but we have to settle for less compelling language, let's say, unfortunately. And maybe in the discussion, Laura may be able to say other things that I can't.